This university has established under the able guidance and blessings of distinguished Padma Vibhushan Pujya Dr. D. Virendra Egade, the Dharmadhikari of Sri Kshetra Dharmasthala, President of STM Educational Society, Honorable Chancellor of Sri Dharmasthala Manjunatheshwara University, Dharwad. STM Educational Society is a premier non-profit educational organization functioning under the sacred aegis of Sri Kshetra Dharmasthala. There are about 68 various institutions under STM Educational Society. STM Sri Dharmasthala Manjunatheshwara University, there are 5 constituent institutes under this university: Medical College, Dental College, Physiotherapy College, Nursing College, and very Heng Institute, Research Institute for Biomedical Sciences. And all other institutes are distributed throughout the state. Sri Dharmasthala Manjunatheshwara University is interested in expanding the horizon of world knowledge, provide a platform for teaching, learning, research and development, and extension activities at various levels in the following faculties. Presently, there are health sciences and biomedical research faculties already working under the university. In future, other faculties like engineering and technology, management and law, Ayurveda and natural sciences, humanities and social sciences, and any other emerging areas faculties will be coming under the university. The major achievements of the university and other institutes of we are very proud to mention that Sri Dharmasthala Manjunatheshwara University is a very young university. It's just it's in second year. It's not even completed 2 years. It's already in the rank 1 of emerging private universities in the country, as published by the Outlook in September 2020, the survey conducted by Outlook iCare, and 12th rank in emerging university in the country by IIRF, Indian Institutional Ranking Framework Ranking System 2020. It stands at 12th rank. As a medical college, is in 9th rank among private medical colleges in South India. It's the 14th rank among private medical colleges all India, and 31st rank in all India colleges all India, is as the survey conducted by WEEK and published on August 30th, 2020. And dental college stands at 5th rank among private dental colleges all India level, 10th rank in dental colleges all India level, and 8th rank among top 18 dental colleges in the country. It's a different surveys conducted by Outlook and WEEK journal. The STM Institute of Nursing stands as 8th rank among top 10 nursing colleges in the country. So coming to STM Research Institute for Biomedical Sciences, this is as I mentioned earlier, it's a very young institute under the newly established Sri Dharmasthala Manjunatheshwara University. The institute has started with an intention of doing advanced research in the area of biomedical sciences to mitigate the unmet biomedical medical conditions. The institute, we have a talented and dedicating faculty with industry, academia and industry experience, and working at national international level. It's an amalgamation of academicians and industrialists. Of the faculty, they have both industrial and academic experience. And thrust areas of our institute are gut liver axis, is the research areas, gut pancreas axis, gut brain axis, glycobiology, autoimmune and inflammatory diseases, stem cells and regenerative medicine. And we are also involved in developing cell-based assays for personalized drug screening. And also, I am very happy to mention that the institute is very young. We are already starting MSc and PhD programs. From this academic year, we are going to start MSc program in biomedical science. And from next year onwards, we are going to start PhD in biomedical science or other biological sciences. Meantime, we are conducting customized Yanshan training programs in cell culture and other laboratory techniques. As I mentioned that we are going to start MSc Biomedical Science program from this academic year. Admissions are open from October 2020 and classes will be commencing from November 2020. Further, I kindly request all the participants to share the information on MSc Biomedical Science program offering by our university with your friends, juniors, seniors and other aspiring students. So thank you for joining us and enjoy the webinar sessions.
I request Dr. Dhananjay Bora sir, hope he's available with us. He has joined us. Yeah, welcome sir.
Hello.
Welcome
sir. Hello. Am I audible?
Thank
you for joining. Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay.
So I'll just try and share my screen. Just let me know if it's visible. Is it visible? Is this presentation screen visible?
Okay, it's coming, sir. Okay. Yes, we can see it, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now, is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Great.
Yeah, so, please carry on, sir.
Okay. Very good afternoon to all of you and all maybe around 90 odd participants present. I would first like to thank the organizers to give me that opportunity to speak to such an audience. I mean, this is my first experience as a webinar.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Sorry for interruption. Could you please be louder a little bit?
Sure, definitely.
Yeah, thank you.
So just let me know if I am not audible. So then I can be louder. Right? So is it okay now?
Little more.
Okay. Now is this okay?
Yeah. It's fine, sir. Fine.
Okay.
Please go ahead.
I would like to thank the organizers initially to give me this opportunity, and personally I would like to thank Professor Joshi to make my job extremely simple. I think he has shared lot of things which I thought of sharing, but due to scarcity of time I was not able to prepare that. But as well now, things are more clear towards how and what nanotechnology is and what it can do. I think my job is extremely simple, and now this talk actually gets connected very nicely to the previous talk which Professor Joshi spent. So thank you, Professor Joshi, personally, to have explained the nanotechnology in quite detail. Okay, so I think what we could say is this opportunity of virtual meeting and webinars. We also could thank to nanotechnology. I mean, in two ways. One, Professor Joshi obviously has explained in quite detail how technology is touching each and each of our lives by miniaturizing stuff. The secondly, thanks to Corona. Again, that's a nanomaterial, that's a nanoparticle. So I think we should thank Corona, that is nanotechnology, to give this opportunity to speak virtually. As Professor has explained quite in detail about what nanotechnology could do, let me take you to a journey wherein what are the challenges in nanotechnology, hence the title, Conundrum. There are serious issues with nanotechnology and currently how it is being perceived. I would like to really connect to the last slide as in abuse of nanotechnology, and I think people should focus more on the abuse of nanotechnology going forward, rather than the positive aspects, as positive aspects are very well known. So I'll take you maybe towards in depth of what I'm doing currently in my research, and I hope I am more clear at the end of the presentation. So I'll start with the same slide which Professor Joshi started, as in definition of nanotechnology, but in a slightly different way. I think nanotechnology is nothing but amalgamation of all branches of science. It's not only science, it is engineering, and then technology. And I hope all of us present here understand what technology means. Technology is nothing but something which is useful to humankind, human being. So that is what we are actually trying to build, fabricate, or make, which is around 1 to 100 nanometers as the definition suggests. Why we are doing this, obviously it has to have come from Wall Street or say BAC indexes, which has to have some financial potential to it, and you could see there is a lot of potential in nanotechnology nowadays. It is growing exponentially, and I hope it would touch around $125 million by 2024. There are top three applications which are being focused currently. One of it is obviously electronics, which we are witnessing. There are energy applications which are on the rise, and obviously biomedical applications because of obvious positives or advantages with nanoparticles to be used in biomedicine. So these are three areas, key areas which are picking up, and they account for around 70% of the global technology market share. So this is kind of the technology resides at this moment, at this point of time. There are different properties which have been explored in nanotechnology, and there are various different things which are being done, not in only terms of nanotechnology per se, as in size, shape, properties, but also different nanomaterials have been in the research very extensively, because people would like to get edge with materials and hence with properties. That is where these different nanomedicine drug delivery agents as well as bioimaging agents are on the rise. I would like to thank as Einstein as well as Feynman, because Feynman, I think he was the pioneer to start this field of nanotechnology. And what he did was, it was an open invitation to all scientists at that time, in which is 1955, to micro nano. Why I'm kind of merging these two, three branches is will be obvious through the presentation which I am running through. Just to tell you in brief is, I think nanotechnology suits very well in terms of sizes. As Professor Joshi has already talked about size diagrams, size charts, BAP is roughly around 2 nanometers. And if you have a particle which is of the same size, I think it becomes easier for a particle to manipulate DNA. And hence nanotechnology, biology, and microtechnology probably are merging hands together to create something which is extremely wonderful. And that is where we are heading towards. So Dr. Feynman, I think he asked some very intriguing questions during the lecture on nanotechnology in 1955. It was definitely not nanotechnology. The title of the talk was, "There is plenty of room at the bottom." I think that was something which was very critical to understand in 1955. And today probably we are experiencing that space at the bottom. So these are some questions which intrigue, and they are intriguing even today. Those some questions are, why can't we manipulate and control materials? Imagine materials atom by atom. It is not molecule by molecule anymore. It is atom by atom. So you pick up one atom, mix with the other, and can we create something which is fantastic or something which is usable? Secondly, why can't we control the synthesis of individual molecules? I think that is going to be very critical, controlling the synthesis. Why can't we read or write at infinitesimal levels? I think Professor Joshi again touched upon this as an AFN. The extension of an AFN, which is known as STM, which is probe microscopy. So that is something which is extremely important to understand how scanning probe microscopy works. It is similar to AFN, but in advancement of an AFN. Fourth is, why can't we swallow a surgeon? I think he mentioned one picture of a movie in 1966. That is exactly what we are currently doing with drug delivery systems. That is, we are swallowing a surgeon. Obviously not as functional, as efficient as a surgeon, but we are reaching there. The fifth is, why can't we build machines to accomplish these things? And that's where again, as what I would say, we are definitely reaching there. We are building tiny nano robots. These probably are will be able to facilitate or use these kind of technologies. Just enjoy this video, and probably I'll go through the presentation in a moment. Thank you. can you guess it right? What this movie is all about? It is nothing but manipulating at nano. Now, every small circle or say sphere which you see is nothing but a silicon atom. And this silicon atom has been controlled by two SPM, that is a scanning probe microscopes, to create this wonderful movie. Now imagine if you could create something like, or control or manipulate something like one silicon atom, I think that the world will be definitely magnificent, or with more functionalities, more applications, and more realization of application when we can control these things in real life. The important point here was to think, and that is what is going to be very critical. So to come to the properties, why is so you and Krar hushes about nanotechnology, and why is the nanotechnology being there for so many years and still we are talking about as newer technology, newer materials, newer application and so on? Because they exhibit some fantastic properties at nano level. Again, as I said, Professor Joshi is to rescue, and he has already explained certain properties. Just to give four different dimensions of these properties, as in optical, magnetic, mechanical and thermal, every property in nano domain behaves in different manner, because it is now no more classical mechanics or classical physics, but it enters into quantum domain. And quantum, because of its weirdness, because of its different kind of nature, I think you can experience various different properties. As in optical case, quantum dots exhibit size dependent emission. For magnetic super paramagnetism, you could see that in nano materials. Mechanical domain, we have very, as you go on decreasing the size, the strength of the material increases because of the surface to volume ratio. And in thermal domain, increased surface energy decreases the melting point of a particular material. And that is what probably we observe. But then, what is all about, these things were all about in physical domain. Let's come to something very different, as in biological domain. How does nano affect in biological domain? Now, at every given size of a nanoparticle, it is affecting in a very different manner. As I could, if I could just run through the previous slide, you could see these colors exhibited by quantum dots. Now, every quantum dot at different size will emit different color. That means one nanometer quantum dot is going to emit blue, as well as 10 to 15 nanometer particle will emit red. And that is where just by changing the size of a nanoparticle in that precision, I think we are going to get different kind of properties. The same happens in biology. For example, a huge particle that is around 1 micron won't be able to penetrate the cell that easily. As you go on decreasing the size, coming to 300 nanometers, there is cathrin mediated endocytosis. So through endocytosis, the nanoparticle could enter the cell membrane. When you come to the size of around 100 to 300 nanometer range, it could be clavulin mediated endocytosis as well as cathrin. And when you go less than 100 nanometers, it is passive uptake. So there is both cathrin and clavulin independent pathways. So nanomaterial could just escape through those pores of cells, and as they could internalize in a cell. So you could see that as you go on changing the size from, let's say, 100 nanometer or less to 1 micron, there are different kind of phenomena you see in a nanoparticle, or how the nanoparticle interacts to a biological matter. The same is kind of captured very well in this particular review published in 2017 in Chemical Society News. I think if somebody is interested, you should go and look at this particular review. It's excellent to understand how nanotechnology actually behaves in terms of biological domains, or how it interacts with biological domains. So we have already studied that, or we know from experience that there are nanoparticles being uptaken, but then cell, as it's an entity, it also throws away nanoparticle out of the body. So there are endocytosis, intracellular trafficking, and also cellular exocytosis. There are red arrows you could see there in the cellular organelles actually are throwing the nanoparticles away, considering them or treating them as foreign agents. So I think these are very essential to understand how a nanoparticle should behave when it internalizes. It is not just mere drug delivery, it just caps something on a nanoparticle and it will just affect. I think there is something in depth to be understood, and that's where probably we are heading towards slowly and steadily to understand these kind of processes. So, as I was mentioning, that every size of a nanoparticle is critical. As you go on changing the size, it changes the properties. It becomes imperative, or it becomes very essential to control the size there. So, obvious question would be how to control this particular size. There are various mechanisms published or say known in literature. One very famous mechanism is how the nanoparticle grows. The nanoparticle precisely grows in two stages. One is a nucleation stage, wherein there is a seed which is sown, and on that particular seed, there is growth which happens. So it generally takes a nucleation followed by a growth event. So there are two events which are responsible for synthesizing a nanoparticle. So you have one atom actually acts as a seed. On that atom, there are molecules or atoms built on to make a nanoparticle. Now imagine when you are handling few atoms or few molecules, thick or say size of nanoparticles, I think the precision in synthesis has to be extremely difficult because these nucleation events are simultaneously happening. So if the nucleation events are simultaneous and if the growth events does not follow the same pattern, you are bound to get different sizes, and that's what you see as polydispersity in a nanoparticle solution. So when you synthesize nanoparticles in bulk, what you obtain is not single size nanoparticle but a polydispersed separation. So what is essential is to separate these two events, that is the nucleation event followed by the growth event. If they happen in succession, if all the atoms basically become nucleated and then they grow, I think it is very easy to then synthesize nanoparticles of the same size, which is highly difficult, very difficult, but not impossible. It could be achievable. So we have tried this control of precision engineering or precision synthesis using nothing but micro reaction technology. I think Professor Joshi again mentioned about MEMS, which is micro electromechanical systems. This is a part of micro electromechanical systems, which is known as microfluidics or micro reaction technology to be more general. So what this technology does is what you have seen in your laboratory, as you have a beaker and a magnetic needle and a stirrer. The same thing you could use, and they are known as active micro reactors. They could be used to synthesize particles very precisely so that we can control the temperature, the pH, the concentration, its flow pattern, as well as the mixing could be uniform. So that is how these reactors could help in synthesizing magnetic nanoparticles or any nanoparticles per se to a particular size regime. And that's what we have tried to have more control on the synthesis using these micro reactors. Again, obvious question, how to fabricate? I think it is extremely simple. I think you could start with a box with some holes, plug out some hair, which is around 100 micron in diameter. I think Professor Joshi again mentioned the same. You just stick these hairs like in any conformation which you want, pour some magical mold material, which is known as polydimethyl siloxane. And once you cure at room temperature or elevated temperature, what you have is nothing but microchannel, as you could see on your screens. This is nothing but a simple microchannel. So you could see these tiny holes. They are nothing but now through and through holes once you remove the wire or a hair from the mold. So that is extremely simple to fabricate a microchannel in that particular fashion. So how to use this? So we used in a couple of different ways. So this was a research which was conducted in my laboratory for past 5 years now. So we have mastered this technology of synthesizing various types of nanoparticles. So we started with actually the basic of nanoparticle synthesis, or say we could say micro reaction, wherein we fabricated these micro chambers. And the black colored thing which you could see, these are nothing but micro needles. These are some micro needles we could easily fabricate in our laboratory. And what we did was use these things to synthesize. You could see the movie at the bottom right corner. So you could see that when there is blue and yellow color liquid, it mixes into the green in first chamber and it mixes thoroughly when you collect at the output. So that is how you can create various different channels, various different reactors by the simple process which is known as soft lithography. So which I showed you earlier. It's also known as template assisted lithography. You could easily use these kind of technologies for fabrication, and hence you could use them in downstream processes for synthesizing two different types of nanoparticles. So we did simulations, we did a lot of things to understand how these things are happening, and ultimately what we have optimized is these kind of tiny reactors which we could then use to synthesize magnetic nanoparticles precisely, or say not magnetic nanoparticles, nanoparticles precisely of all different types. So when you look at these kind of micro reactors, I think just a closer look will tell you a lot in detail of understanding how these reactions take place. Why I'm saying this, because precision is the key. I think it is very essential to understand how these reactions take place, what is the rate of reaction, what is, should be the concentration, how to slow them down, how to increase the speed of the reaction, so that you can get complete synthesis, complete mixing, and so that whatever we are synthesizing is more precise and we have more control on this. So what we did was, we tried to understand how these things happen. So what we did is, we broke this flow down to a tiny droplet. So what we hypothesized was, inflow reaction is nothing but a droplet reaction if you freeze time. So at this time freeze moment, what we have is two droplets basically mixing. And once we mix these two droplets at different time points and understand or see them in under scanning electron microscope, I think we could understand a lot of how the nanoparticles basically get synthesized. So if I move from 1 second to 30 seconds at any given temperature, let's say if I talk about room temperature, which is 27 degrees centigrade. So when we move from 1 second to 30 seconds, that is reaction time of 30 seconds, wherein the two droplets are mixing, you could see at 1 second a lot of unreacted product. As you move from 1 second to 3 seconds to 5 seconds, you could see there is some particles are emerging. And when you go from 10 seconds to around 30 seconds, you could see fantastic particles, very uniform in size. And if I see the image at 4 degrees of 30 second SEA picture, you could see very tiny particles of same size. This is nothing but to have more control or understanding how we can have more control on synthesizing different types of nanoparticles. So what we hypothesized was, maybe droplet reactors could maybe be much better, so that we can have complete reaction, precise control of temperature, precise control of reagents, precise control of pH, and so on and so forth, so that we can synthesize these particles very beautifully. So to take this thing forward, rather than having droplets and suffering the effects of yield, what we thought was, why not to take this forward and automate this? So the best thing was to do a mathematical model, or go to take resort of something known as CCD, that is computational design, that is central component design. That is a tool, that is a mathematical model which we could use to fit different kind of parameters. So what we thought was, there are specific parameters governing a particular reaction. Can we synthesize, or can we equate into a formula where S becomes the size and C, T, that is capital T, small t, W and F are different parameters of the reactor. So that C becomes concentration of the reagents, T, that is capital T, is the temperature, small t is the time, V becomes the flow rate, and W becomes the rotational acceleration. V or F is the same, this is flow rate of a particular system. So if we control the flow rate, it is directly proportional to size. If we control the rotational acceleration, that is the speed of the magnetic needle, it is definitely will affect the size, and so on and so forth. Can we equate, wherein K here becomes the constant of the reaction, the complete reaction, and it will also denote the errors observed in the reaction. So this K will kind of nullify the errors, and it will give us more precision in synthesizing these kind of nanoparticles. So to take this forward, we started with first gold and silver nanoparticles. So this was the equation which was obtained for SAG is for silver and SAU is for gold. You could see silver is very precise as compared to gold, wherein K denotes the error in the synthesis. So this figure which you could see on your right hand side is the figure for parameters for silver synthesis. You could see very beautiful monodispersed particles which you would see in the image. The standard deviation is around, let's say, 10 nanometers or so. So, and what we did was, now we could predict size. So we could actually predict parameters to get a particular size. So if we say we could put into the size, let's say 60 or 50 nanometers, we could get back all the parameters. And then if we synthesize those parameters, then we can have precise control on the reaction and we can get back the size. And that is what the whole chart tells you about. In this particular figure panel, C is nothing but an AFM image, which Professor Joshi talked about. It's an atomic force microscope. To that, we can do excellent imaging of nanoparticles. This is an AFM image of different size nanoparticles of silver, which is 20, 40, 60, and 80. Further, they were used to used in biology, I would say, so that to understand how a silver nanoparticle will affect, or rather than silver nanoparticle in a general term, what would be the effect of size of silver nanoparticles on different kind of components? So this is the concentration input versus viability chart, and that is the ion release. You could see that a 20 nanometer particle would release more number of ions as compared to an 80 nanometer particle. So our 80 nanometer particle has a sustained release for 72 hours, wherein a 20 nanometer particle would release very at a burst release rate, higher release rate in 12 hours, and slowly it saturates. Similar to the effect of viability, a 20 nanometer particle is kills more number of cells in terms of concentration ppm as compared to an 80 nanometer particle. So you could see that when effect of 20 nanometer silver is very harsh, high as compared to 80 nanometer silver. So that is, just by changing size of a silver nanoparticle, you could observe these kind of effects. And that's what we have seen in NIH 3T3 cell lines. You could see these are the control cells of NIH, and you could see different nanometer size particles. They are very internalized. You could see this green colored one, which are internalized. This is the reactor oxygen species which are generated using 20 nanometer particle. As we move from 20 nanometer to 80 nanometer, you barely could see any effect. Maybe in this particular cell, there is some effect of killing because of silver nanoparticles. Similarly, we understood the cascade activity, that is the death of a cell. As you could see in the table here, a 20 nanometer particle could kill cells which is around 42% killing, whereas 80 nanometer particles is near 9% killing. Now you could see, now you could probably would comprehend the effect of size basically on its effect in biological terms. So for example, in NIH2-3D, you could see the effect easily, wherein the smaller size affects more than the larger size. So that is how the size of a particle would affect, and that's the reason precision in engineering this particle is very critical. So we moved from, this was the simplest because silver and gold are reduction chemistry, that is it just reduces to give you gold nanoparticles or silver nanoparticles. So we tried to move from very simple kind of reaction to more complicated reaction, as in synthesizing cadmium telluride nanoparticles. These are nothing but quantum dots. As I was mentioning earlier, quantum dots are nothing but fluorescent nanoparticles, which gives out color depending upon size. So 1 nanometer would give you blue and red. A size of around 15 nanometer would give you red color cell. So this is, again we use the same kind of design, that is mathematical equation by predicting parameters, and this is what we have got. So this is the PEM of I think green colored quantum dot, and this is the optical image or say graph of different size nanoparticles. You could see maybe around, this is the blue colored one, and this is the red colored nanoparticle. And this is, you could see a K value that is very high because this is a complex synthesis. It involves temperature. The earlier was very simple reaction, the reduction reaction. This is highly complicated reaction, and hence the errors in the reaction are very high. And the sizes what we are obtaining in this particular sense is extremely low. You could see that the sizes is around, let's say 3 nanometers to around 15 nanometers in diameter. This is an optical characterization. What we did was to ensure that we could use these nanoparticles in biological matrices. We have created deliberately to more biocompatibility. CDT itself is toxic. As we know, gold, silver, not gold, but silver is toxic. Similarly, cadmium telluride also is toxic. And hence, to have this more biocompatibility, coated with gold. Coated with PDMS, that is polydimethyl silver, which is a biocompatible polymer. So by coating this particular polymer, you could see that it is more biocompatible. As well, what it did was it increased its quantum efficiency, that is quantum mean. So a bare particle now is, let's say 20 to 25% efficiency in terms of quantum efficiency, whereas a PDMS coated particle will give you around 60-61% efficiency. Similarly, it will be more stable in terms of photostability because it will give the color for a longer duration as compared to bare quantum dot, that is only CDT nanoparticle. So this particular picture shows you how the size, basically with size, the color emission changes. So this is how we could synthesize in a microreactor not only gold, silver, but also CDT nanoparticles. We checked this release profile also. So you could say that a bare release is faster and a coated one release is very slow, and hence the toxicity of a coated particle, that is PDMS coated quantum dot, reduces significantly in terms of its toxicity. The same we have done the viability assay, depending upon concentrations, you could say easily say that around 12.5 microgram per ml is safe to use in any cell line. We did in vitro imaging, and here what we did was we conjugated these nanoparticles with different kind of targets. For nucleus targeting, we use MAR1 protein, and for the cytoskeleton targeting, we use actin antibodies. And similarly, you could see these are the nuclear targeting and IPL. This is cytoskeleton targeting, and you could see this is both as a merged nave. Now, the beauty of these nanoparticles is in normal fluorescent microscopy, what we have is different emission would give you, different excitation will give you different emission. Whereas in quantum dots, what you need is only single excitation. So all these nanoparticles are excited at 350, that is UV. And what you get is different kind of excitation or emission wavelets. In case of blue, it is around 450, and in green, it is 550 nanometers as an emission. So you could have single shot microscopy rather than doing a sequential or stacking of microscopy using different kind of stains. Here you could do a single shot microscopy wherein you could use different kind of colored nanoparticles, that is quantum dots, and you could use only one single laser, that is around 350 nanometers, which is UV. And have all colors simultaneously rather than spending time and thinking more about the excitation emission pairs and also thinking more about the stability of these different kind of fluorophores. So these are extremely stable with high quantum efficiency, as well as they could give you the image in one shot, that is in single shot. So we move to the next. Target was understanding this in vivo application. So we use zebrafish model. And then what we did was we injured the heart of a zebrafish and understood how these cells could be, how these nanoparticles could be used in understanding the proliferation of the cells. So what we did was we conjugated these quantum dots with two different antibodies. One is to recognize cardiomyocyte and other is proliferating cell nuclear antigen. So these two antibodies we conjugated onto quantum dot, which is green as well as red quantum dots respectively. And you could see that after the injury, this yellow colored line is nothing but the injury line. And you could see a good amount of proliferation in terms of cells after the injury. And you could see these kind of cells are proliferating, that is the PCNA. You could see, and it demonstrates the, that is the cardiac tissue is recovering and a healthy, it shows or demonstrates a healthy cardiac tissue. So that is how we could use these nanoparticles. Rather than doing sequential microscopy, we could also use this in one shot, single shot microscopy, and it could help in much better imaging. So what the concentrations of quantum dots which we have used is extremely low, maybe some 20 microliter per ml or so. So these are very, very sharp colors or very bright colors you could get using confocal imaging. The next was more complex reaction in terms of using polymer nanoparticles. So currently we have been using silver, gold, that is metal, as well as semiconducting nanoparticles in terms of CD and PE. So we wanted to test our reactor, can we, or maybe we want to challenge ourselves to say, can we synthesize polymer nanoparticles? Now why polymer is a challenge? Because of its molecular weight. Polymer basically comes in chain lengths, that's the need, that's the reason it is known as polymers. It is n number of mers which actually add n number of molecules which join together to form a polymer. So that is how a polymer is made. And what we need to understand is because of its high molecular weight, the reaction to control the reaction is going to be very, very difficult, or it is difficult rather. So to get a size below 100 nanometers of cytosol nanoparticles was challenging earlier, but what we have demonstrated from the micro reactors which we have used, we could easily synthesize polymer nanoparticles below the size of 100 nanometers very faithfully. That is, every time we could synthesize with these parameters, we could get to the 75 nanometer size very easily. And the SD, that is the standard deviation, also is extremely low. You could see the standard deviation in the chart given there. So we can get around 75 nanometer particle with the standard deviation of 9 nanometer or so, which is extremely monodispersed when you talk about a polymer nanometer precisely. Metal as well as semiconductor are much easier because of the grain boundaries, whereas polymer doesn't have a grain boundary, and hence it is extremely difficult to synthesize a polymer nanometer particle with high degree of monodispersity. Again, we have used the CCD technique, that is the mathematical modeling, to generate an equation. Now again, if you could focus on the k factor, that is the constant factor, here the constant factor is immensely high, which is 2.2 × 10⁶. This huge number is because of the complexity of the reaction. So this particular reaction is extremely complex, as I was mentioning, because of the polymer molecular weight. And hence, the engineering or precision of synthesis is extremely critical as well as difficult. Panel C gives you an AFM graph, which you could say that these particles are highly precise as well as monodispersed when we synthesize using this microreactor, different kind of microreactor. Again, we subjected these particles to cells. Here in this particular case, we have used two different cell lines. One is NIH3T3, as well as which is a mouse fibroblast cell line, and MDAMD is a breast cancer cell line. So in these two cell lines, we subjected different size nanoparticles from 75 nanometers to 600 nanometers, which was synthesized using a mathematical prediction technology or methodology. So you could see that in 75 nanometer particles, these particles actually enter the cell nucleus or cell membrane, and it is actually going near to the nucleus. Now, if you could remember the slide which I showed you in the introduction section, wherein less than 100 nanometer particle size, they are passively uptaken. You could see here that is less than 100 nanometer particle, which are around 75 nanometer particle, are passively uptaken, which can easily reach to the nucleus of the cell. As you go on increasing the size of these nanometers, nanoparticles, what you could say is, there is barely something which is penetrating inside the cell. 600 nanometer particle sits outside the cell membrane and cannot penetrate inside very easily. So that is how we could actually tune the drug delivery response, or then load the drug in that particular manner of a particular size, and you could easily see an effect of these nanoparticles. The same kind of effect you could see in NIH3T3 cell line, which is given in the bottom panel. A 75 nanometer particle internalizes very easily, as well it goes closer to the nucleus, whereas the 600 nanometer particle is barely visible outside the cell. So what we did was, rather than just waiting there and seeing a qualitative image, we calculated using image J and analyzed how many particles basically internalized. So you could see here in this particular top table, again, this is not MCF, this is MDAMD, mistakenly it has been written MCF 7. 75 nanometer particle, what you have is around 810 particles which could internalize, whereas when you go to a 600 nanometer particle, you could have only six particles which could internalize, which of that particular size. When you come to the NIH3T3 cell line, around 856 particles get internalized, wherein only 4 particles internalize when you talk about 600 nanometer particles. So you could easily see the effect of size on the nanoparticles as well as its internalization pattern. So what we did was, next was, can we use this actively in biology? For example, can we synthesize these nanoparticles or load drug on them? So what we did was, we did some modification in our reactor dimension, or say engineered this particular chip. So rather than having only two wells, we had the third well. In the third well, what we did was, we loaded drug. So here you could see that in this particular graph, this is time-dependent cumulative release of micromixer. So the blue line suggests the cumulative release, which is done using a conventional technique. That is, what we did was, we synthesized these nanoparticles and loaded drug later on. And in this particular chip, it was done in situ. That is, during the synthesis, drug was loaded. And you could see a very nice graph of cumulative release. So you could see that there is a burst release initially in this particular section, and followed by a very slow and sustained release later in the time points. So this is a graph of around 300 hours. So similarly, what we could see is a size dependent drug loading pattern also. 75 nanometer particle could be loaded very high, a high amount of drug could be loaded. So around 70% drug could be loaded onto 75 nanometer particle. Wherein when you come to the size of around 600 nanometer, barely around 50% drug could be loaded. Similarly, the drug release pattern, you could see that is again dependent upon the size. 75 nanometer particle actually releases quickly, whereas the 600 nanometer particle releases slowly. So now why we did all these things was to understand the effect of release was, can we tune or tailor burst release coupled with the sustained release so that the efficacy of drug could be enhanced? And that is where I think this all these engineering would help, rather than having the burst release and then withering out the whole drug. So can we tune the size of a nanoparticle as well as its drug loading in such a way that we have both this sustained release as well as burst release to cure initially and then sustain later on, so that we can tune these things in a much better fashion. Similarly, the caspase 3 activity was seen in these cell lines, and you could see a 75 nanometer particle, you could see a lot of green color, that is caspase activity and apoptosis death, cell death by apoptosis, whereas in particle sizes of around 600 nanometers, you could barely see anything which is being killed. So that is where around 68 to plus minus 3% apoptosis was observed, when only 26% apoptosis was observed in the particles of around 600 nanometers. This study was carried out for around 24 hours to 48 hours, depending upon the particle size. So to summarize, in using these micro reaction engineering, using these different kind of nanoparticles, we could elicit different kind of responses in cell. So it is not only synthesizing a nanoparticle, but synthesizing the nanoparticle precisely, controlling in size, I think it is more critical. So that is what is the conundrum of nanotechnologies. We have different kind of sizes being synthesized, that has collective sizes with more polydispersity in the particles. So if we could get to a true monodispersity, so you could see a silver particle is around 5% monodisperse. A CVT is around 4% monodisperse, and a polymer particle, which is cytosine nanoparticle, is around 8% monodisperse. This is high degree of monodispersity which we have tried to gain or achieve in terms of engineering the reactor, saying it is the shape as well as the size of the microreactor and the control on the synthesis or parameters of this microreactor using mathematical modeling. So we could achieve a lot of different size particles, and we could show the effect of sizes of nanoparticles in cells. Just to summarize, monodispersity conundrum could be solved using microreaction technology. Why I'm saying could be because there is a lot of things to be done, because as I was mentioning earlier, when we would be able to solve this completely, when we would be able to join two atom by atom and synthesize that. So that is the reason it is still a journey, it's a process, and it is still won't be I think stopping until unless we realize this kind of future wherein you would be able to synthesize nanoparticles using atoms. We have discovered that the reaction parameters severally and collectively determine the size. It is not only one single parameter which is essential. I think it's an interplay of all the parameters which are important when you synthesize different kind of nanoparticles. The mathematical prediction of process parameters yield true monodispersity, which is around 5% in the preparation. And these polymer or silver nanoparticles have been used effectively with drug loading as well as to assess its toxicity effects. And such technology can be utilized as bedside to administer fresh nanoformulation. So these nanoparticles could be thought of being a surgeon which has drug, and it could be loaded directly or say infused directly into your bloodstreams, where they could look for the problematic areas and could be able to solve. Similarly, a cancer or an ulcer or so on and so forth. I think before I go, I should thank this excellent team of different people coming from different backgrounds. So the top panel are all past students, and the right hand panel are current students working with me. And the funding agencies I should acknowledge for funding this kind of a research. Thank you so much for attending this seminar and for giving me this opportunity to speak what I do in this particular level.
Thank you. Dhananjay sir, it was indeed a great presentation and very informative. And especially the video of a boy and his atom, which shows manipulating how the manipulate the nanoparticles, and also the mechanism of synthesis. We were very impressive. Micro reaction technology, and was curious to know more about this. And application of these specialized nanoparticles in cancers and cancer cells and in cardiomyocytes study in vitro and both in vivo. Thank you very much. And I hope Dr. S.K. Joshi sir is available with us.
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. Dear participants, now the session is open for discussion. If you have any questions, please post in the chat section. And I have already received a few questions. And hope everybody. The first question is for Jyoti sir. Does this fullerene is synthesized by chemical synthesis or microbial fermentation technology?
It is by Dr. Chetan Teke, right? Does fullerene synthesized by chemical? I think regarding synthesis, Dr. Bodas is the right person to say. I don't think I can answer this.
Okay, sir. It's chemical technology. I hope Chetan is clear about this. And does any preclinical studies are going on this method?
They are not into the practical field.
Okay.
Application are not come.
Okay, sir. Okay, so what is the role of these nanoparticles in ointments?
I said ointment are surface medicine.
Okay,
so they do maintain the aging factors of the cell and balancing those hydrophilic and lipophilic balance, and that is the cause for aging of the cell. It's the one. Other are usually they are also used in the to prevent the movements ahead, and some local applications are done there. They are all just local applications used mainly for skin and not beyond that, as far as I know.
Okay, Dhananjay sir, any crucial shed a light on this? If you want to add something on this.
Yeah, I think ointments are, there are two types of. One, as professor was mentioning, it creates a layer. The other is it has surface properties. Basically, the surface of nanoparticles are charged surfaces, so they could easily penetrate. So what is essential is to understand is nanoparticle basically releases ions. And these ions have then further effect. So nanoparticle, what it does is it creates that possibility of having sustained ion balance or ion presence, so that it could be more effective. So that is what nanoparticle layer actually does when you use as an ointment.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you. We have one more question from Sweta. Does nanoparticle synthesized using medical plant extract be really useful in drug discovery? Can it be really effective?
Yes.
Okay. So it means we can take any potential plant extract and mix with the nanoparticles, and then later on we can use it for making.
Yes, but then the care should be taken, because of plant extracts has a lot of chemicals there. So if you are really worried about the precision in engineering nanoparticles later, what you need to understand, what is an active ingredient, what is the molecule which is responsible when nanoparticles are being created. So I think a lot of research is being done using plant extract because of the biosynthesis process. But then I think a real care should be needed and required when you are translating this technology into more industrial scale. Research is okay, but when it actually gets translated into industrial scale, there are a lot of challenges there using plant extracts.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Joshi, sir, you want to add something?
No.
Okay, thank you, sir.
There is one more question. What the X stands for by Dr. Chetan? What the X stands for? Endohedral fluid, we know that it is a cavity. And inside the cavity, whatever that element which you want to put it and send it to the particle, that you can put it inside. And that particular particle or structure or particle is not known, just a representation of endohedral fullerene. X is the material or the drug or whatever that you want to keep inside that fullerene, that becomes endohedral fullerene. XC60 means you are putting something, anything which is not known here. X represents the element which you are going to put inside.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you. Okay, I think we have one more question from Vishal. He asks, what are the nanotech solutions available in India at present for circulating tumor cells, isolation and enrichment for subjecting the CTC sample to cytogenetics?
I think there are a couple of companies who are detecting the CTCs from patient samples. I think we should look at those companies. They are doing excellent job. But what is being done currently is all detection of CTCs is using fluorescence microscopy. So that's what I understand what is correctly. So what is essential is the enrichment, what you are mentioning is absolutely true. Isolation as well as enrichment has been a challenge, and kind of it is unsolved challenge. I mean, there are a few companies who have mastered this technique of isolation as well as enrichment, but then again the detection takes a lot of time. So what is challenging is if you could get a blood sample or any serum sample, if you could detect the CTCs right from the blood sample without rather enriching and isolation, because isolation enrichment steps are going to take a lot of time. So what people are doing is people are using different kind of biomarkers along with nanotechnology so that these CTCs could be detected very easily. So that is what current technique is being done for detection of CTCs.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Sir, I have two questions, very basic questions regarding nanoparticles, biodegradable and bio non-degradable nanoparticles. Once we consume the nanoparticles, either the way, whether it's through the, as a medicine or through liquid form as a supplement, after pinocytosis or endocytosis, the accumulation of nanoparticles, do they have any role in the cytoskeleton structure, on the cytoskeleton structure, and do they have any role in inducing any kind of mutation? Is a chronic acute accumulation or chronic accumulation condition of nanoparticles?
I think what is essential to understand is the dose. I mean, how many or what kind of nanoparticles are being taken up. So the concentration dependency is very critical here. So what generally we do is we actually are using nanoparticles which is below toxic limits. So am I audible clearly?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes,
sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes,
sir. So so I think that is what is going to be important. That is the dose. And as I was mentioning in the earlier slide, it is not only about endocytosis. Cell also has a process as an exocytosis. So these nanoparticles are actually thrown away, that is out of the cell membrane. So it is not only that this nanoparticles internalize and they stay there forever, cell also takes a remedial action to throw these nanoparticles away. So then whatever remains is basically toxic to the cell. If it is toxic to the cell is going to die, and it is going to be more either necrotic or apoptotic cell death, depending upon the pathways which are getting initiated. So I think what your question is absolutely right. There is lot of things to be done as in to understand what is the accumulation of nanoparticles and in what quantities. So what the question should be is, if the dosage is taken for a longer period of time, then the accumulation is definitely going to be there, even though we are talking about renal clearance or exocytosis and so on and so forth. I think that kind of question is currently unanswered, and it actually comes to a more social response from the society to take up this particular challenge and a question, to answer this question accurately, as in, is nanotechnology is going to be only helpful, or it has a flip side, as Professor Joshi was talking about, an abuse of nanotechnology. I think what we are now looking at different kind of aspects is, which are in terms of abuse of nanotechnology. It's overuse of nanotechnology, which probably we are looking at. So I think what you are asking is absolutely true in this scenario, that we are slowly and steadily heading towards the abuse of nanotechnology or the use of nanotechnology.
And topical application of nanoparticles in the form of slurry or any paste kind of things in radiation therapy, do you think there is a enhanced treatment effect for any kind of cancer tissues, solid tissue cancers?
I cannot comment because of the deep seated tumors. I don't know. I'm not sure. If you could inject the nanoparticles inside the tumor or maybe to the surface of the tumor, then maybe we could have enhanced effect. I'll share one story with you for radiation effects. So currently, a lot of people are using sanitizers, especially these silver nanoparticles based sanitizers. It is nothing but you are rubbing a sanitizer on your hand. If you are using a mobile phone, when you are applying these sanitizers, you could easily sense this some tingling sensation on your skin. So this was one of my colleagues, which they are actually doing research on a fabric with silver nanoparticles. So what they are doing, they are using mobile covers which could have silver nanoparticles, so it becomes an antimicrobial, antiviral agent, so that no virus particles would be fit on to or sit onto the mobile phone. But what she is experiencing is this tingling sensation. So what is being done there is, when you speak and when there are RF radiations which are emitted from the mobile antenna, they are charging these nanoparticles, and those are known as surface charges. And because of the surface charges, your skin actually has a tingling sensation. Now imagine, and there is also a heating effect, that is localized heating effect. So if this is going to be the effect of nanoparticles in such low doses, I'm pretty sure that if you could inject nanoparticles onto a tumor site and use RF, I think they would definitely have a severe effect on the tumor. But then it is not going to be localized, probably it might be on the whole body, so that is the care should be taken.
Okay, thank you, sir. One more is regarding Rajendra Swami Iremudu. Rajendra Swami Iremudu has mentioned about the Bhasma in Ayurveda, an example for nanoparticles. Here, just I would like to mention about that during our childhood, when we visit temple, even at our house, when we do pujas, that time we put, it's very common in Karnataka, I don't know about other parts of India. They were giving some little vibhuti to all the kids. We were eating vibhuti powder. It's like bhasma, similar bhasma only. Do you think that that was is a concept of nanoparticle concept?
Yes, definitely it is. But then it is polydispersed nano preparation. It is not monodispersed. So I think bhasma preparation has a specific way how they prepare these bhasmas. And definitely it has an efficacy, and it has an effect on human body. But as I said, as similar to a plant extract, what is going to be the exact size, what is going to be the contributing molecule, if you could deduce them, that particular molecule from the bhasma, I think then it would be more important as we could go forward. So currently the Ayurvedic challenge is repeatability, reproducibility. So if a particular drug is working for some individual, I think in the same formulation, it should work for the other individual also. I'm not undermining the Ayurveda here, definitely, because I am also a follower of Ayurveda and I do believe in Ayurveda. But then the challenge is this, to explain to a Western world, if something is working on a particular physiology of a person, it should work, it should have similar effects on the other person on the same concentration. Currently, bhasmas are not able to do that in every individual, because bhasmas were prepared looking at the physiology of a person, if I am not mistaken, if I understand Ayurveda correctly. So, a Vaidya, say a Ayurveda doctor, he would analyze your pulse, and according to the pulse and the physiology of person, he used to prepare those basmas and add those little bits of medicines in that quantity, that is, or that concentration, which are kind of personalized medicines.
Yeah.
Right. So if we consider that space into the personal medication, I think basmas would definitely stand its chance as a personal medication. But then, if we want to prove it to a global world, global scenario, we need to do analysis as in what is the active ingredient and what would be the change in and maybe relationship of that active ingredient in terms of physiology of a person. So if we could correlate that, I think there definitely lies a chance of making this technology towards more technology as such, accepted technology.
Okay, thank you so much, sir.
Okay, Joseph, sir, would you like to add something on Basma in Ayurveda, sir?
As Dr. Bauda said,
yes, sir.
A very complicated procedure of creating a Basma. Gold, you are converting into Basma, you are converting one type of that material into a different type. And that process changes the quality of that gold. It will not remain as a gold, it will have medicinal property, which they already found out. The process also they have established, and then only it's the real therapeutic medicine as to be done, mentioned in Ayurvedic scriptures, old scriptures. A routine basmas, whatever that you do, we don't know anything about it, but a classical basma should go. The deep and the very deepest and strict process of creating basma, I think Boris is already in the area of synthesis of these what you call this nanomaterial, is a very complicated one. Similarly, this gold also, gold basma, an example, it definitely changes its characters from metal to something, a medicine, going through a strict steps of conversion. Definitely, it has got nano element and nano application.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
So we have a few more questions lined up for Boda, sir. Maybe we'll take how is the biological synthesis of a nanoparticle done? And they are saying it is not very clear how this it is done biologically.
Pardon, I couldn't understand the question. Can you please repeat?
How is biological synthesis of nanoparticles done? They say it is not very clear. Okay.
I mean, it is not biological synthesis, it is chemical synthesis.
Chemical synthesis.
It's okay. Application of nanoparticles into biology. So it's not biological synthesis.
Chemical or physical.
Okay, sir. So we have one more question from.
This is the last question, sir.
Maybe, yeah. Our last question we can think. The nanoparticles drugs can kill the surface cells by any means, but what about the core cancer cells?
The nanoparticles principle of using them in cancer is one is early detection and stop its growth further. By using biomarkers and all, it will go a particular cell after having detected and the heat is generated, it is killed. When it manifests as a mass itself, I have not read anything or role of nano in that. I think Dr. Bodas may add on that.
It is difficult. It is seriously difficult. It's not simple. Everybody is kind of mentioning so much of positives about nano, I think it is good to understand nano has certain effects for sure, but then it has its disadvantages too. So the disadvantages lies in the relapses. I mean, when you are treating with nano or any drug, I think what we are considering is the relapse of a cancer. So I think there, killing the core of a cancer probably is under study. They are targeting or trying different kind of targets which could actually change the cell or mute the cell, the cancerous cell. That is precisely a cancerous cell. And that technology currently uses siRNAs and similar kind of techniques. So that we could understand cancer first in more detail, and then maybe we would be able to use more of therapeutic for these kind of biomaterials such as siRNA for more therapeutic purposes. So I think the research is still going on and it has not reached anywhere, so that it could be translated into a market.
So give us the information, sir, as soon as something comes out of the research, and roll up nano in a big tumor mask.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you, sir. One last question, sir, to Bora, sir. So you mentioned about mathematical prediction synthesizing nanoparticles. Are there any specific softwares available for this for prediction purpose?
Yes, MiniTag is a software that will give you MiniTag, MiniTag. So that is a software which will be able to use these different kind of methods. So Taguchi is one of the technique used for, so this is nothing but design of experiments. Basically what you do is, if there are multiple parameters, you use design of experiments, and then central component design is one of the way you could design an experiment and extract parameters. So once you have this, then you have to fit it into the equation. So there is a different process. So you can use MATLAB. MATLAB has certain tools which could be used, and MiniTag will give you this kind of, it is a couple of two different softwares. It's, you don't have something which is straightforward.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, sir. Thanks for answering all the questions. And I would like to call upon Dr. Ajay Kohli to give validation speech.
Thank you, sir. It's a great pleasure or an honor to propose the vote of thanks to all who have helped us in making this online webinar such a resounding success. On behalf of SDM RIPS team, I will thank to our Honorable Dr. Niranjan Kumar, Vice Chancellor of SDM University, who has a backbone for arranging this event. And I also thank to our beloved Registrar, late Colonel U.S. Dinesh Sir, for his constant support. I would like to thank our distinguished speaker, Dr. S.K. Joshi, Pro Vice Chancellor Academy, SDM University, for making excellent and presentation, making this seminar interesting and meaningful. And also, I would like to express another renowned speaker, Dr. Dhanraj Bodas, Scientist E, Agarkar Research Institute, Pune, who has accepted our invitation spontaneously and given an excellent speech over nanotechnology in medicine. I would like to thank our beloved director, Professor Palaksha KG, for his moral support and guidance. And even I am expressed to vote of thanks to our staff members, Aradhya K. Mutt, Pravanjan Gai, Ajay S.K. and Mallukarjan Goni, and non-teaching staff, Ms. Sunita and Ashok, who have made this webinar a grand success. I am very grateful to thank especially IT department, Mrutunjay and his team for their efforts in arranging this webinar. Finally, the wonderful participants who have turned up in such a great number from different part colleges and department and university for attending this seminar. We are hope your constant support will be there for our future organizing events. Thank you so much for your cooperation. At last, I can no other another answer make but thanks and thanks. Thank you one and all. Vande Mataram.
Thank you, Dr. Bodas. Nice having met you.
Thank you very much. Sir. Thank you. It was a nice presentation
from your side. Thank you so much. Kya vayat kai karaycho? Thank you.
Mona.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, both of them, sir.
Thank you,
Dr. Palaksha, and whole of your team. Good sir. Job. Well done.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir.